evening, sir. Sir, majority of youth today is aiming to go to foreign countries for their education. So what according to our loopholes in our education system and what can we do to improve it?
Foreign systems. And number three, our educational systems are not accountable systems. These are the three significant loopholes. A system which is not merit-based, a system which is not transparent, fully transparent, it is bound to be a victim of discount by the various intruders or people who are there a part of that system. Why is it we look towards developed world? Just because of three reasons. Their systems are merit-based. अगर आपके पास मेरिट है तो आपको कुछ जमाने की जरूरत नहीं है. जमाउन देता का जमा देते क्या? मेरिट बेस्ड सिस्टम्स. अगर आपके पास मेरिट है, उनकी एग्जामिनेशन के अंदर में आपने क्वालिफाई किया, आपका मेरिट सर्टिफाई हुआ, आपको एडमिशन कोई डिनाई नहीं करेगा. एक सिस्टम्स आर ट्रांसपेरेंट. उस सिस्टम की क्रेडिबिलिटी इस बात के ऊपर में डिपेंडेंट है कि वॉट एवर इज जनरेटेड आउट ऑफ द सिस्टम it is made known to you and your opinion is taken on, including your level of satisfaction is given a due cognizance, and system is accountable. If there are any shortcomings and loopholes and if there are any unbecomings, immediately diligent steps are taken for the purposes of correction, and that correction is put into public domain, put onto a need analysis, verification, standardization and validation. We still are operating in an aristocratic system of education. And therefore, until and unless we are determined about these three significant transformations, and who is to do these transformations? Until and unless those who are expected to be the beneficiaries of the system. System के अंतर्गत आपको क्या चाहिए? कि जब तक उसके अंदर आने वाले beneficiaries आग्रह के साथ खड़े नहीं होंगे, आप मुझे बताइए, आप curriculum बनाते हैं? आपका करिकुलम कैसा होना चाहिए इसमें कभी आपकी राय ली जाती है? आपका सिलेबस कैसा हो इसमें आपका से है? आपका से नहीं है. आपका टीचिंग मेथड कैसा हो इसके अंदर में आपका से है? नहीं है. आपका लर्निंग क्वेश्चन कैसे डिफाइन किया जाए इसमें आपका से है? नहीं है. हम बिल्कुल एक फ्यूडल सिस्टम के अंतर्गत ऑपरेट करते हैं अपने आप, और फ्यूडल सिस्टम के अंतर्गत डेमोक्रेसी के वैल्यूज सिखाते हैं. कंट्रास्ट है. इस कंट्रास्ट को जब तक हम फीड बैक ऑफ द स्टेक होल्डर्स डज नॉट बिकम पेरेंट टीचर्स नीड. मैं आपको विनम्रता से कहना चाहता हूं, एक केवल महजी दिखावा है. इसके अंतर्गत कुछ बहुत रचनात्मक पैदा होता है ऐसा मैंने नहीं देखा. कदाचित मेरा ये अनुभव और मेरी ये सोच गलत होगी, और ये अगर गलत आप साबित करते हैं तो मुझे खुशी होगी. बट दीज आर ऑल रिचुअल्स दैट वी कंडक्ट. And hence, the real classical ambience which is required to be created, where the learner should be in a position to learn by joy. आप आनंद के साथ सीखती हैं कि डर के मारे सीखती? डर के मारे आप आनंद के साथ नहीं सीखती. हमारा लर्निंग इज नॉट बाय जॉय, हमारा लर्निंग इज अंडर कंपल्शन, हमारा लर्निंग इज अंडर रूल्स, हमारा लर्निंग इज नहीं तो मैं का होई मार्क नहीं मिळाले तो मग आई काय म्हणेल, गुणवत्तेत नाही आलो तो मग माझा काय होईल. या दडपणाखाली जेव्हा शिक्षण होत असतं तर कुठे ना कुठे ज्या शिक्षणाचा मूल भाव आहे ते आपण बाजूला सारतो. अँड इट इज दॅट विच इज एंटायरली हॅपनिंग. हेन्स देअर हॅज टू बी एन असर्शन ऑन पार्ट ऑफ द लर्नर्स. अँड नंबर टू, द फीडबॅक विच वी आर वॉन्टिंग टू बी गेटिंग आउट ऑफ दीज टार्गेटेड स्टेक होल्डर्स, that should be taken as a credence for the purposes of evolving of the policies. That according to me is going to be a real day of sunrise for all the levels of education in regard to its reforms in this country, from unitary to its ultimate manifestation. Otherwise we are passing through a difficult phase.
Main aapse puchna chahta hu ki gurukul shiksha pramani behtar thi ya vartman?
Ye samruddhashali lagta hai. आप देखिए, गुरुकुल पद्धति जिस रूप में वर्णित की गई, निश्चित तौर पर उसमें एक आत्मीयता का अनुबंध था. तैत्तिरीय उपनिषद ये पूरा उपनिषद है जिसके अंतर्गत गुरुकुल परंपरा की मीमांसा, गुरुकुल परंपरा की व्याख्या व्याप्ति दी है, जिसका मैंने चिकित्सक अध्ययन किया है। और मैं चाहूंगा कि गुरुकुल परंपरा की कथा कहानियां सुनने के बजाय गुरुकुल परंपरा का क्या स्वरूप था, ये आप तैतृय उपनिषद के अंतर्गत देखेंगे तो आपको अत्यंत आनंद आएगा। कालांतर के साथ में चीजों का पद्धति का प्रारूप बदलता है। आज भी अगर हम ये मान करके चले कि पूरा एजुकेशन रेसिडेंशियल कैरेक्टर का हम कर डालें, भाई नंबर्स हमारे लिए फिजिबल नहीं है। और इसमें गुरुकुल परंपरा का वह रूप जो तैतृयोपनिषद में वर्णित है, जो वैदिक परंपरा का हिस्सा है, जो हमारे अतीत के अंतर्गत गर्भित था, उसको उसी रूप के अंतर्गत अपना पाना संभव नहीं है। परंतु जो चीजें अपनाई जानी अनिवार्य है, गुरुकुल परंपरा की सबसे बड़ी खूबी यह थी कि शिक्षा के दीक्षांत समारोह के अंतर्गत गुरु अपने विद्यार्थी को तीन आदेश देता था। और तीन आदेश क्या थे वो मैं आपको तैतृय उपनिषद के कोट करके बताना चाहता हूं, जिसका स्वामी विवेकानंद जी ने उल्लेख करते हुए उन्होंने तीन आदेशों की जगह चौथा आदेश दिया, मातृ देवो भव। पढ़ लिखने के बाद में आपकी श्रद्धा या माता को देवता के रूप में, देवकी के रूप में स्वीकार करे, ये उसकी पहली आज्ञा है। पितृ देवो भव दूसरी आज्ञा, राष्ट्र देवो भव तीसरी आज्ञा, और इन तीन आज्ञाओं के साथ चौथी आज्ञा स्वामी जी ने दी, दरिद्रो देवो भव चौथी आज्ञा। इन आज्ञाओं का स्वरूप आप समझिए, आज पढ़ लिखने के बाद क्या सचमुच में मातृ देवो भव है, क्या पढ़ लिखने के बाद पितृ देवो भव है, अगर है भी तो क्या राष्ट्र देवो भव है, और खुदा न खास्ता राष्ट्र देवो भव है तो क्या दरिद्र देवो भव है, नहीं। व्हाट इज, इट्स नॉट द सिस्टम, इट्स नॉट द बेटरमेंट और कॉम्प्रोमाइज नेचर ऑफ द सिस्टम, इट इज द वैल्यू इनकार्नेटेड इन दैट सिस्टम। The change that has taken place is गुरुकुल परंपरा, शिक्षा की परंपरा, ये वैल्यू बेस्ड थी, मूल्याधिष्ठित थी, पर मेरी और आपकी जो सिस्टम है वो वैल्यू बेस्ड न होते हुए प्राइस टैग्ड है। और हम अब ये इंटरप्रिटेशन करने लगे कि दोघांमध्ये फरक काय, जे प्राइस आहे तेच वैल्यू आहे, आणि म्हणून प्राइस टैग सिस्टम हीच वैल्यू टैग सिस्टम म्हणून गणली जावी, हा मूर्खपणा आहे। असं कधी झालं नाही, होऊ शकत नाही, आणि याकरता नाही होऊ शकत की मूल्य आणि व्हॅल्यू याच्यामध्ये फरक मोठा आहे। ज्याला किंमत असते ती किमती, पण ज्याची किंमतच नाही केली जाऊ शकते ते बेश किमती, आणि जे बेश किमती आहे ते व्हॅल्यू आहे। ज्याला प्राईस, ज्याची प्राईस केली नाही जाऊ शकत, केली गेली तर मोजली नाही जाऊ शकत, आणि मोजली गेली तर भरून दिली नाही जाऊ शकत, ते व्हॅल्यू आहे। याच सिस्टीममध्ये जर आपण व्हॅल्यू बेस्ड इनकॉर्पोरेशन केलं तर ही गुरुकुल परंपरेच्या समकक्ष होऊन जाईल, त्याचा ओलावा आपण आणण्याची गरज आहे। ते जर आपण आणू शकलो तर तुमच्या प्रश्नाचं उत्तर समर्पकरित्या दिलं जाऊ शकेल।
My question to you is, how far is our education system of school is helpful in our career?
Piece of your school education. If you really ask me what is the infrastructure or the plinth on which the entire suprastructure of the career is built, it is your primary and secondary education. They are the core edifices. It's what exactly is inbuilt on this is going to be the entire proposition on which your any career that you choose will be in a position to be taking shape. This is basically because the entire nature of primary and secondary education is generalistic in character. It is giving you an entire wide range. It is talking of mathematics, it is talking of life sciences, it is talking of social studies, it is talking of environment, it's talking of arts, it's talking of commerce, it talks of science, it talks of languages, it talks of English, literature, first language, second language. Therefore, the ambit that you are being subjected to is huge and broad. Whereas what is happening is, from your broad based, when you are entering into the career making, the apex is narrow. The narrowing is taking place. Like if you are going to be in analytical domain, mathematical domain, it is in the engineering and technology and the other sciences. If you are wanting to be entering into the domain of life sciences, it will be biology, zoology, botany, environmental sciences, bioengineering, biotechnology, the bio part of it that takes you to the second part. But then, until and unless your base is broad, your pyramid cannot be created. Therefore, the broad base is available only through your school education. And therefore, those who are singularly devoted in the entire process of school education, assimilating that broad base, they are the ones who are in a position to make their career very efficiently, very diligently, with a focus, with an understanding, by virtue of being atop in terms of a narrow apex. Suppose if the pyramid is inverted, is it possible that you will be beginning with small and then broadening it? An inverted pyramid on its tip, will it be ever in a position to stand? It will never be in a position to stand. A pyramid of education can stand only in case if it is with a broad base and a narrow apex. And that's exactly why we call it primary education, secondary education, and then finally the narrow apex is tertiary or higher education. Broadest is primary, mid is secondary, and highest is tertiary. Tertiary is the career making. It will be sufficient and it will be civilized only when you are through with the broad-based basal part of the pyramid. Therefore, the breadth of the school education is something which is significant, vital, capable of holding the apex of the pyramid in the name of tertiary or higher education.
Thank you, sir.
I told you there is no... And even today, the cost of technology not being affordable, it will be a manual connect out of emotional bondages. As I gave one of the propositions in the previous answers was, it is not a connect which will be geographical. It has to be a manual connect. If my heart bleeds for somebody in the distant area whom I want to be in the mainstream, I should take the onus. The whole problem is we are concerned. Har maa ye chahti hai ki samaj mein Shivaji hona chahiye. पर जब पैदा करने की बात आती है तो पड़ोसी का घर उसको ज्यादा उचित लगता है. एंड इट इज एग्जैक्टली हियर देयर वी आर डिफीटेड. देयरफॉर रूरल एंड अर्बन कनेक्ट टिल सच टाइम इट टेक्स प्लेस इन द डोमेन ऑफ इकोनॉमिक पैरिटी बाय वर्च्यू ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजिकल इंटरवेंशन इट विल बी द इंडिविजुअल इंटरवेंशन बाय ए फिलेंथ्रोपिक माइंड विच अलोन इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू बी द आंसर. एंड देयरफॉर माई आंसर वॉज ईच वन टीच वन. Each one, reach one, and that's the only way.
To you, is that how the political problems and corruptions can be stopped through the education of children?
All over walks of life. And this is something which is very difficult to deal with. The reason being, the whole problem lies in the demand-supply ratio. Demand is huge, supply is scanty. When the demand is huge and the supply is scanty, the buyer is at the receiving end and the seller is at the bargaining end. Everybody wants good access, and good access has the cost. Good access has all other considerations which become open and which become operable. It is basically because of this gap between demand and supply. Like, as a parent, I want my child to be admitted to DPS school in Nashik. Admitting capacity is say 100. And there are 1,000 people who are keen. What happens? There is an opportunity. Well, I will bypass the merit. I will accommodate you, but at this extra cost. This could become bad. The problem is not that A is intending to do it and B is wanting A to come to that level. The problem is demand and supply ratio, which is the real problem. Here the number of students or the number of beneficiaries which are wanting to be in, they are huge, and the avenues are small. Avenues are minimal. If the avenues are broadened, if the demand supply ratio will always create. If you are a student of commerce, agar aapko padhaya hoga commerce mein, to buyers and sellers market padhaya jata hai. What is the buyers market and what is the seller's market? Buyer's market is one where buyer dictates And seller's market is one where seller dictates. Today, education is not a buyer's market. It is a seller's market. Therefore, seller's market dictates. It's the seller who dictates. The real necessity is more avenues, more schools with equitable avenues, with near equal standards. Then only the answer will be generated. Otherwise, this problem, in the name of demand and supply, will always be as it is now. Maybe in case this demand-supply ratio is not corrected, situation will go out of hands and it will become bad. It will turn from bad to worse rather than being corrected.
I'm studying in 9th class. I would like to ask you, sir, how is it possible that in foreign countries, even though they are of the poorer strata, they get good education, but in our country, they are of the poorer strata, but they don't get the good education, even though the policies are made?
Access to education is not... You will be surprised if I say that at the 13th five-year plan commencement, what is the excess of higher education that we are contemplating? We are wanting it to be raised from existing 15% to 20%. What does it mean? It means out of the 100 those who are eligible to get higher education, we are able to provide only to 15%, 15% of it. What happens to the 85%? Our eligible population is too huge and our available opportunities are too minuscule. Therefore, there is a huge mismatch. As compared to many other countries which may be having poorer GDP than us, their numbers are not that big as that of ours. Therefore, they are in a position to work them out. Like classical example I will give you. Korea is one of the countries where the things were tough and difficult. But they have worked out, and qualitatively they are superior to us practically in all yardsticks. Comparatively a smaller country, smaller population. You and me are a country of 125 crores, out of which the eligible population for higher education is nearly 52% of the total population. And the avenues that we have in a position to accommodate is only less than 20% of that population. Therefore, A, there is a compulsory dropout. And B, there is a forced dropout. What is the difference between that student who does not get into an MBBS course scoring 98% because the admission was closed at 98.1? What was the difference between those two? One who got 99 and one who did not get admission at 98. There is no difference. But the option in which he or she is forced to is something which is compromising. You dreamt for your life to be into one stream. You do not make it, and you are compelled to be accepting something which is your second or maybe your compulsory choice. Will you be ever in a position to prosper in an arena of your forced choice or compulsory choice? The answer is a big no. We are a victim of larger numbers, poor infrastructure, non-planned development of infrastructure, and therefore, until and unless philanthropic domain in the education operates, perhaps we will not be in a position to mitigate this problem. Governmental support alone will never be in a position to solve this problem. It will be the philanthropy which is expected to be the hallmark of heralding and actualizing this change. Otherwise, we are in a tight spot.
Thank you, sir.
The victim of poor understanding and gullibility. People are able to sway those who are gullible, but not those who are educated. I can be swayed in the name of my caste very easily if I am not literate, if I am not educated, if I am not conscious, if I am not assertive. One of the most significant assets which education gives to you is right to assert. You have a right to opinion. You have a right to understanding. You have a right to clarity. You have a right to expression. And you have a right to have expressed assertive expression. Means education takes you away from your vulnerability and your gullibility. Social harmony in this country is acceptance diversity, acceptance plurality, and that acceptance comes by exalted levels of understanding. Education is one of the agents which generates exalted level of understanding. Today, I can be divided because I'm willing to be divided. But tomorrow, when I will be in a position to be a reasonably sound man out of my logic, by virtue of education, it will not be easy for anybody to sway me. And therefore, education becomes one of the significant aspects by virtue of which the various divides which are artificial, they can be fissured, they can be bridged, and a real harmony can be created. Hence, education, in my humble